Okay, thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 8073 in the name of Angus Robertson on Arctic connections, Scotland's growing links with the Arctic. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Angus Robertson, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I move the motion in my name and signal the Government's acceptance of the amendments tabled both by the Scottish Labour Party and the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party. I hope this reflects a positive cross-party approach to Scotland's relationship with our Arctic and Northern neighbours. Today's debate provides a welcome opportunity to highlight the importance for Scotland of continuing to collaborate with the Arctic region. Scotland is, in fact, the world's most northerly non-Arctic nation. Unst in Shetland lies further to the north than Cape Farewell in Greenland, Juneau in Alaska, and Whitehorse in Yukon. Scottish waters stretch 200 miles into the Norwegian Sea, well into the 63rd parallel north, and similarly into the North Atlantic Ocean. So from an Arctic perspective, Scotland's location at the edge of Europe is far from peripheral. Quite the opposite. We are in a key strategic position connecting the European Arctic with Central Europe and North America. And there's growing international recognition of the constructive role that Scotland can and is playing as a close sub-Arctic neighbour. While our geographic proximity is a key asset, there is much more to Scotland's developing collaboration with the Arctic region. Indeed, present-day links build on centuries-old ties that remain visible across Scotland in place names, in heritage, in architecture and in culture. Scotland's compass has long pointed north in search of beneficial partnerships and knowledge to realise opportunities and now increasingly collectively address global challenges. Scotland's largely rural profile, sparsely populated regions and abundance of natural resources are akin to the Arctic. This creates similar opportunities such as those concerning the blue economy and green energy production. But there are also shared issues arising from remoteness in particular, for instance, in relation to connectivity, to resilience, to climate adaptation, depopulation and public service delivery. Scotland has developed a wealth of expertise on such issues that is relevant to our Arctic partners. And for that reason, Scotland was a valued contributor to the European Union's Northern Periphery and Arctic programme. More than 40% of the projects in the 2014 to 2020 round had at least one Scottish partner. The UK Government's choice to step away from the NPA and from other European programmes is yet another practical example of the harm caused by Brexit. The Scottish Government continues to explore channels to associate with the NPA and with other programmes in future. To reflect the strategic importance of collaboration with Arctic partners, the Scottish Government published Scotland's first Arctic policy framework back in 2019. My colleague Fiona Hislop launched the document in Stromness in recognition of the historic ties between Orkney and the Arctic. Our framework sets out how we will cooperate and share knowledge with Arctic partners. It's an invitation to pool expertise to unlock well-being and prosperity for Scottish and Arctic communities with a distinctive hands-on approach and strong community focus. Unlike other narratives, which often focus on taking from the Arctic, our framework sets out Scotland's offer to the Arctic and focuses on offering and on sharing. Since publishing the framework, we've intensified engagement with domestic and international stakeholders to open new avenues for Scottish Arctic cooperation. The engagements I've undertaken recently make clear that Scotland's expertise is increasingly warmly received and warmly sought after. Last October, I addressed the Arctic Circle Assembly in Reykjavik and was joined by a large Scottish contingent of researchers, third sector and cultural organisations. At the Assembly, I opened a session on rural mental health organised by the Scottish Government in partnership with the Research Council of Canada and the University of the Highlands and Islands. And exactly 1 month ago, I was in Tromsø for the annual Arctic Frontiers Conference, where I was invited to join a panel discussion on rural repopulation in a session with the Norwegian Prime Minister Jonas Gahr Støre and US Senator Lisa Murkowski from Alaska. Later this month, on the 17th of March, we will partner with Arctic Frontiers to host a one-day forum on Scottish-Arctic collaboration at the Aberdeen Science Centre, and I hope that colleagues from across the chamber will consider attending the event. Our framework commits us to support Scottish organisations to pursue deeper and broader collaboration with Arctic partners. And with this in mind, in 2021, we launched a new Arctic Stakeholder Fund. And to date, the scheme has supported 20 innovative and value-adding projects, and work is now underway on a new round of the fund. Many of the projects work with Indigenous organisations, including to promote and protect Indigenous languages. One of the brilliant projects that we've supported this year is led by the Polar Academy, which is a West Lothian charity that works with young Scots experiencing mental health challenges. After a rigorous training programme, the Academy takes them on a life-changing polar expedition in Greenland. This year's expedition will set off in the coming days, and I want to wish all the participants an exciting but safe trip. Perhaps the best examples of the pace at which Scotland's collaboration with Arctic partners has progressed has come from the academic sector. When our policy framework was published in 2019, Scotland had two members in the University of the Arctic, an international network of institutions producing research in and about the Arctic. Today, 9 Scottish universities are members of UArctic, and I'm confident more will join. We have more members than Sweden and of any other non-Arctic nation with the exception of China, something which we should be proud of. In recognition of our growing status within the network, UArctic chose St Andrews to host, with government support, a leadership conference last May. We've also helped fund the establishment of a Scottish Arctic network, bringing together academics and researchers from across Scotland with expertise in the Arctic. And I'm very pleased to inform Parliament that on behalf of the network, the University of Edinburgh will host the Arctic Science Summit Week in 2024. This is one of the world's largest gatherings of Arctic research organisations. Supporting research and making best use of available scientific evidence is critical to tackling the dramatic changes that the Arctic is experiencing. Melting glaciers, sea level rises, and the escalating pace at which the region is warming is illustrative of the devastating effects of climate change. These changes do not stay in the Arctic, they reach our islands and our coastal communities too. And as a pioneer of renewable energies and decarbonisation, Scotland can offer expertise and help catalyse international efforts. Tackling the climate emergency has become the single most important element in Scotland's partnership with Arctic nations. And as we know, the green shift is also an economic opportunity, particularly for our partnership with Arctic nations and with Arctic regions. Together, they represent more than a quarter of our exports, and there is ample potential to increase this. Our draft energy strategy and just transition plan further underline the opportunities to work with northern neighbours to create shared strategic advantage and establish regional infrastructure to meet domestic and international renewable energy demand. In addition, our Arctic policy framework and the new National Planning Framework 4 highlight how Scotland can create a near-Arctic marine transport and logistics hub. The University of Strathclyde, hosting the 27th Conference on Port and Ocean Engineering under Arctic conditions, the first time in the UK, is further evidence of that. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, today's debate has created space to set out all that Scotland is already achieving in our partnership with Arctic nations and to demonstrate our ambition to grow these powerful links further. We are strategically located and have a wealth of relevant experience to make Scotland not only a key partner in the Arctic, but also a shareholder in its future. And in moving the motion in my name, I hope that Parliament will support and welcome these ambitions for Scotland and for our Arctic neighbours too. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Donald Cameron to speak to and move Amendment 8073.1. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I move that amendment in my name? We welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate on how we can continue to enhance our relationship with our Arctic neighbours. And of course, while international relations is a matter reserved to the United Kingdom government, I would stress that the Scottish Conservatives believe that it is important for Scotland to engage with Arctic nations in order to promote and advance Scotland both economically and culturally. Now, of course, neither Scotland nor the United Kingdom is technically an Arctic nation, but it remains vital that we work alongside the Arctic nations to enhance our own climate goals, to build on our existing security commitments in the region as well. Now, that latter point is particularly critical given Russia's ongoing illegal invasion of Ukraine and the need for other states to remain united in their condemnation of that conflict. The Arctic region is a unique and fragile ecosystem that faces a range of challenges, from climate change to resource extraction, from the aforementioned geopolitical tensions to indigenous rights. And as a global power, the United Kingdom clearly has an important role to play in promoting sustainable development, protecting the environment and supporting the people of the wider region. But as has already been said, Scotland too shares many cultural, environmental and economic ties with Arctic states, and it is evident that we also here in Scotland have a unique role to play. And I would want to focus my remarks in this speech on that role, and also for the need for the Scottish Government and the UK Government to work together on enhancing stability and security in the region. Now, we welcome, for instance, the publication of the UK Government's updated Arctic Policy Framework, which we believe should complement the existing work detailed in the Scottish Government's 2019 framework. Both governments rightly place climate change at the heart of each of their respective frameworks and the need to work in partnership with other nations who face similar challenges as Scotland. And the need to share best practice on tackling the climate crisis is recognised by both governments, given the fact that, as a country, the United Kingdom is directly affected by changes in the Arctic region as one of its near neighbours with much shared biodiversity. And it is deeply concerning that the Arctic is warming at four times the global average, which is increasing the risk of extreme weather, flooding and environmental degradation. I think it's right to say that by 2028, Arctic summer sea ice cover will have declined by 155,000 square miles, an area 1.5 times the size of the UK. So with that in mind, it is welcome that tackling the climate crisis and halting further biodiversity loss are key tenets of both frameworks. We also acknowledge the need to promote a prosperous Arctic where economic and commercial development is achieved in a way that is safe, responsible and sustainable. And as we continue to recover from the pandemic and rebuild our economy, it's right that we work with other Arctic nations to grow our trade links. The Scottish Government's 2019 framework notes that Arctic countries account for around 27.5% of our total exports and five of our top 20 export destinations as of 2017. From a Scottish perspective, we know that this further development can be achieved through the Global Scot and Trade Envoy Network, which we on these benches recognise the benefit of. However, as the UK framework notes, we must ensure that any new trade with the Arctic region doesn't damage the Arctic's natural environment or destabilise peaceful cooperation, which are fundamental to the prosperity of many Arctic communities. It's vital, particularly when we consider the rights of indigenous groups in the Arctic region, and that's something that both governments' frameworks emphasise. Can I turn to the security aspect of this debate? Russia's ongoing conflict in the Ukraine poses several major challenges for the Arctic region, not least because Russia has held the chairmanship of the Arctic Council since 2021. Its term is due to end later this year. And in addition to this, it's plain that Russia views the Arctic as strategically vital to its prosperity and security and has increased recently its military presence in its Arctic territory. Other areas of concern include the fact that Russia has established a new Northern Joint Strategic Command and has reopened Cold War era bases above the Arctic Circle. Those are just some of Russia's recent actions, and it's vital that the UK government continues to work closely with our strategic partners in the region to monitor this further. And to that end, I do welcome the Ministry of Defence's recent publication of the UK's defence contribution in the High North, which reaffirms the UK government's commitment to the wider High North region. And that includes several key objectives, including the need to protect critical national infrastructure, the need to ensure our freedom to navigate and operate across the wider region, the need to reinforce the rules-based international system, particularly the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, and finally, the need to contest malign and destabilising behaviours. These are important objectives, and while defence, of course, again, remains a reserved matter, I hope that where joint working is possible between the Scottish and UK governments on this matter, that will come to fruition. To close, Deputy Presiding Officer, it's clear that Scotland has an important role to play as a non-Arctic nation alongside the key Arctic states. whether that be through the joint working on tackling climate change, growing our economic interests, or enhancing the region's security. Scotland and the UK can be major contributors to these shared endeavours. And the UK and Scottish governments clearly share several common goals, something which may be rare, but is extremely welcome. To that end, I can confirm, Deputy Presiding Officer, that we will be supporting the Scottish Government motion today, as well as the Labour amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Cameron. I now call on Sarah Boyack to speak to and move Amendment 8073.2. Around 5 minutes, please, Ms Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I do want to welcome today's debate and believe that there are two contexts to it. Climate security and global security. So I move the amendment in my name. And I want to start off by saying that I very much agree with the general thrust of the motion, and indeed the speeches made both by the Cabinet Secretary and by Donald Cameron. Climate security has to be a key priority for this Parliament and for legislators across the world. The last few years have shown us the devastating impact of failing to address that climate emergency. It's something we discussed, for example, at our January cross-party group in Pakistan, in terms of how we support their rebuilding their economy and their country after a third of that country experienced massive floods, something that would have been unheard of 10 years ago. Last year, we also had excellent discussions in our Commonwealth Parliamentary Association's online seminars, where we shared the work of our Scottish Parliament on sustainable development. So there is much more we could do in sharing best practice, but it's absolutely central. I thought it was great, for example, that our presiding officer led a delegation to the Nordic Council last October. For our islands, our rural communities and coastal regions in particular, we need to exchange best practice on low-carbon energy production and heat networks, especially now given the cost of living crisis we're experiencing. And for our cities, the work that Denmark has done on building municipal low-carbon heat networks, for example in Copenhagen, is something that we urgently need to adopt. And we need to reduce our transport and building emissions if we are to deliver on our own climate targets. But so much more to work with our neighbouring countries and our neighbouring legislatures so that we can work together to enable that transformational shift that the world needs. And given the climate crisis, our work with our Arctic neighbours has got to be part of our agenda as a Parliament, as well as the agenda of the government. And I think the Arctic Council has already been mentioned. It brings together those nations with territory in the Arctic Circle, the USA, Canada, Russia, Denmark, Iceland, Sweden, Norway and Finland. And it is worth noting that they have worked together since 1996 to promote cooperation, giving Indigenous nations a formal voice and addressing conservation as a key priority. The Council has coordinated work on addressing biodiversity, conservation, pollution, sustainability, tourism and shipping. The UK is an observer at the Arctic Council and has contributed to several of the papers it's published, particularly on biodiversity and pollution. We had the Scottish Government's Arctic Connections paper published in 2019, again highlighting the common challenges and opportunities. And as the Cabinet Secretary focused on academic links in particular, I do agree we need to strengthen and build those academic links with universities across our regions. But I also think we need to focus on enabling our students to have more opportunities to study in neighbouring countries and to build our connections for the long run too. I think that's important. I also wanted to highlight one of the key recommendations that Scottish Labour proposed last year in Gordon Brown's commission, which was looking at being able to sign international agreements in devolved areas, which I think in the aftermath of the excellent connections we made at COP26 in Glasgow, I think that's something that we'd be very keen to pursue. So there's an awful lot in this motion we're able to agree with, but I wanted to amend it because it doesn't mention the other issue that countries in the Arctic Circle are currently focused on, which is global security. And as we debated in Parliament last week, Putin's invasion of Ukraine has shifted global politics. So it's important to acknowledge that in relation to the Arctic, the Russian government has decided to make changes to its state Arctic policy, which removed reference to cooperation with the Arctic Council and instead prioritises solely Russian national interest. I think that's deeply concerning, And I wanted us to note that as a Parliament, because although climate change should be our priority, we cannot afford to delay the radical action we need to protect our communities. We know that sea level rise, melting glaciers and extreme weather are becoming increasingly prevalent, and the Arctic region is particularly vulnerable. So given our global climate crisis, we need global cooperation, regional cooperation, with governments working together, Parliament sharing best practice, not pursuing agendas that undermine that collective ambition. And as we debated last week, peace in Ukraine, with Ukraine's sovereignty recognised and a withdrawal of Putin's troops from Ukrainian soil, is absolutely critical. But we also need to acknowledge that that invasion has actually impacted on wider global security and work together. So I want to conclude, Presiding Officer. I support the broad thrust of the Government's motion today. I also support Donald Cameron's amendment, and I wanted to flag the damage being done by that invasion, which is impacting on global security and diverting the political energy that we all need to work together to address our shared climate emergency. So we should support our Arctic neighbours, given that the temperatures in the Arctic continue to rise way above the global average. We need to promote that joint work across our neighbouring governments and parliaments. It's not just in our interests, but it's absolutely vital to the interests of our future generations. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. And I now call Liam McArthur.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I warmly welcome the fact that time has been set aside for this debate. It may reflect the Government's desire to keep Parliament's agenda rather uncontroversial over the next few weeks, but if that is the case, then today's debate represents the acceptable face of the SNP leadership contest. And can I congratulate members who've spoken so far, both on the tone and the substance of their contribution. Presiding Officer, the islands I represent are often described in this chamber as remote. They've even been called communities at the edge. Yet when it comes to the Arctic and discussions about what Scotland and the UK's strategy should be in relation to the Arctic, Orkney is smack bang at the heart and the centre of things. And not just geographically. Orkney's connections to the Arctic Circle are long-standing and ones of which we are enormously proud. Orkney and Shetland, of course, were a Norwegian province up until 1472. Workers for the Hudson Bay Company started heading across from Orkney in 1670, and Arcadians made up two-thirds of the workforce by the 1800s. Arcadian explorer Dr. John Ray discovered the final link in the Northwest Passage in 1854, though sadly history has yet to fully afford him the recognition, respect and gratitude he's due for those astonishing efforts. During the World Wars, the Royal Navy was based in Scapa Flow, and Orkney's strategic location served as an important departure point for the Arctic convoys, delivering vital supplies to the north of Russia. And the names of our people, homes, our natural habitat are often unmistakably Nordic. Little wonder then, as the Cabinet Secretary reminded us, that when the Scottish Government was looking for somewhere to launch its Arctic policy framework back in 2019, Orkney stood out as the perfect location. And can I pay tribute to Fiona Hislop, who was the minister at the time, and who I know retains a very passionate commitment to these issues. Indeed, she and I, along with Mark Ruskell, attended the Arctic Circle Assembly late last year, referred to by the Cabinet Secretary, a visit that for me certainly reinforced the conviction that these are ties, relationships we need to build and broaden as a Parliament, through government and local government, and through business, academia, and wider civic society. It's a model we've already seen proving enormously successful in the development of Scotland's relationships with Malawi, and I see no reason why it can't be adapted to suit the Arctic context as well. And there's no lack of policy areas where these closer ties at all levels are desperately needed and which could deliver real, immediate and lasting benefits. Climate change is the obvious example and was very much the focus of much of the discussion in Reykjavik back in October. Temperatures in the Arctic continue to rise at four times the global annual average. Rapid loss of sea ice, melt events on the Greenland ice sheet, wildfires and permafrost thaw all contribute to rising sea levels and extreme temperature events beyond the Arctic. In fisheries too, we have a direct interest in the Arctic region in promoting sustainable use of stocks and responsible science-led management of our respective waters. With vast natural resources and strong expertise in energy innovation, Scotland and the Arctic countries can continue to lead the way in the development of marine energy and green hydrogen. Reykjavik also underscored for me our shared interest in finding low-emission solutions to ferry transport and cruise line traffic. To my earlier point, these are areas where I believe Orkney can be in the vanguard on behalf of Scotland and the UK, while also acting as a stepping stone for Arctic countries and regions looking to develop relationships the other way. So in concluding, can I urge the Cabinet Secretary to support Orkney Islands Council and other partners in developing Orkney Research and Innovation Campus in Stromness as a centre of excellence for Arctic and Nordic research and partnership? And will he agree to follow in the footsteps of his predecessor Fiona Hislop and organise a follow-up to the 2019 conference in Orkney with a focus on building economic, political and research relationships? I'm looking forward to a positive response from the Cabinet Secretary to those suggestions, and look forward to a consensual debate throughout the course of this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. MacArthur. And we'll now move to the open debate. I would advise members that we do have some time in hand for interventions or perhaps additional points that members would wish to make. I call Fiona Hislop to be followed by Jamie Halkett-Johnson. Mrs.
Presiding Officer, I am very pleased that Parliament is holding this debate today. I have a long-standing interest in Scotland's Arctic connections. As the then Cabinet Secretary, I published the Scotland's first ever Arctic policy framework, having previously mobilised Scotland's many academic, business, community, scientific, environmental, transport community and health connections in an Arctic summit in Inverness, as referred to, and I'm delighted that there will now be an International Arctic Exchange Conference in Aberdeen. I also hosted Nordic ministers at the first ever Nordic Council meeting held here in Edinburgh, and have twice attended the Arctic Circle Assembly in Reykjavik. So why Scotland and the Arctic? We all have an interest in protecting and promoting the Arctic, and Scotland has great scientific monitoring on sea temperatures, for example. Parts of Scotland share the experiences of remote living, and important strands of sharing our connections of our young people, digital health expertise, and our higher education connections made through membership of the Virtual University of the Arctic. And it's good to hear the expansion of that membership of our universities. Liam MacArthur indeed led our parliamentary delegation in October to the Arctic Assembly, where we met ministers from Iceland and elsewhere and discussed tunnel links with the Faroes minister. Icelandic MPs were also interested in our mission-led Scottish National Investment Bank. To give a sense of knowledge exchanged more widely by thousands of global delegates at the Arctic Circle Assembly, Scottish experts shared our insight on renewable wind energy developments, where we are seen as world-leading. Inuit knowledge to live with the environment and the rich culture of the sea, the sky, and living in tough circumstances was powerful testament. And of course, Arctic countries are interested in our management of wetlands. We shared the bad experience of degrading peatland in the 1980s with inappropriate tree planting, as they consider tree planting. It is also profound to hear that when the tundra thaws in Alaska, houses built with no foundations just collapse while families sit at home watching TV. We were delighted to host the Icelandic Environment and Communications Committee that we met in October here in January in a joint meeting with the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, where heat and building standards, onshore wind and wetlands management and carbon capture were on the agenda. Iceland is investigating onshore wind developments and are interested in our experience. They see potential to export hydrogen through major grid connections, although politically that is contested. I will also touch briefly on more geopolitical and environmental interests. The melting of Arctic ice will bring rising sea levels, and it will also see the reopening of the Northwest Passage, which will mean freight shipping will be able to cut many miles and much energy use in traversing the world using this route. Deep water ports en route with potential for hydrogen fueling of energy hydrogen to power them is a common interest. And I know Orkney and others are interested in that longer-term development. But it also brings marine defence issues and issues around mineral exploitation, and much of the governance issues need to be resolved, but resolved by Arctic nations. Arctic nations are cautious of many economic and military interests, so countries need to be sensitive in approaches, for example, for observer status of the Arctic Council. But as with the Nordic Council, Scotland has insight and experience to offer as a good faith partner in less controversial areas. And indeed, there are those in the UK government who think Scotland is best placed to represent common interests with Arctic countries. The Arctic matters to everyone, and the people of the Arctic are key. So our people-to-people approach can, yes, broaden our horizons, but can forge partnerships to help change and face an Arctic which is changing and will affect us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hislop. I now call Jamie Halkett-Johnson to be followed by Richard Leonard. Mr Halkett-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Scotland has been described as the Arctic's nearest neighbour, and as somebody from the Northern Isles, as Liam MacArthur is, I can assure you it's not lost on me, particularly when a polar blast hits our islands. But our island's connections with the Arctic countries is more than just the weather. As Liam MacArthur said, until the 15th century, we were part of Norway, and many local names, including my own, are of Norse heritage. Stromness was the important recruiting centre for the Hudson Bay Company, and many Orcadians travelled to Canada, settling there, others playing an important role in that country's development before coming home. And Orford, where I live, was the home of John Ray. And I should take this opportunity to declare that I'm a member of the John Ray Society in Orkney and commend their excellent efforts to promote his legacy and to preserve his birthplace, the Hall of Clestron. Mapping around 1,750 miles of Arctic coast on foot and in small boats, Ray's discoveries helped shape our understanding of the Arctic region. And I also commend the work of the Orkney-Norway Friendship Association and its efforts since 1978 to promote links between Orkney and Norway. These are long-standing cultural and historical ties that we share with our Arctic partners and should continue to celebrate. But new relationships are now being forged, and our strategic role as the world's most northerly non-Arctic nation only enhances the value of increasing collaboration between Scotland and our Arctic partners. And we're seeing this in a number of fields. Orkney's world-leading European Marine Energy Test Centre has partners from across the world, and including Norway. And many of the wind turbines around our coast and onshore too are Danish designed and built. And there's much to learn from these shared experiences of Arctic countries and how some of the problems we face can be solved. A significant challenge for many communities across my Highlands and Islands region and Arctic countries is depopulation. And connectivity is an important part of combating this. I know my colleague Douglas Lumsden will talk about ferries, but there's a lot we can learn from some of the Arctic countries about fixed links, joining our islands and communities with tunnels and bridges. It's a subject Fiona Hislop touched on just then, and I've spoken on before, and it's something which communities across Scotland want investigated, and we need to see more action from the Scottish Government in considering that too. And of course, broadband is vital, both for businesses, but also for the social fabric of our societies. And while Scotland's RA 100 will be at least 7 years late, leaving many of my constituents in the Highlands and Islands reliant on slow or non-existent broadband, next year Space Norway's programme will provide broadband coverage throughout the Arctic. And there are also serious considerations here too. Scapa Flow, which my home overlooks, was the UK's main naval base during both World Wars. And our islands played a vital role in the Atlantic convoys, which kept the UK supplied. But now the shadow of another threat, an old threat, has returned. Russia's aggression in Ukraine puts at risk the Arctic region as one of high cooperation and low tension. And as my colleague Donald Cameron also highlighted, I welcome the UK government's publication of their Arctic policy framework last month and their commitment to work with Arctic partners and other allies to contest, and I quote, malign and destabilising behaviours and activity in the region. And more positively, that the UK government is committed in its 2021 integrated review to maintain a significant contribution to Arctic science with a focus on better understanding the implications of climate change. Presiding Officer, the United Kingdom, Scotland and my Highlands and Islands region shares many common challenges with Arctic countries. And as we look to the future, our strategic location and our historic and cultural ties with the Arctic countries present a unique opportunity for more collaboration and partnership. And I hope that both UK and Scottish governments work together to that end.
Thank you, Mr. Halker-Johnson. I now call Richard Leonard, followed by Gillian Martin. Mr. Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The latest United Nations World Investment Report records, and I quote, increased foreign influence in the Arctic. China has described the Arctic as a global commons, as it planted a flag on the seabed 2.5 miles below the North Pole. The Russian Navy declared the Arctic is Russian. And of course, the 45th President of the United States of America, Donald J. Trump, even thought he could buy Greenland on terms he described as, I quote, essentially a large real estate deal. So when the government talks about the Arctic as a safe, stable and peaceful region, I hope that they acknowledge that there has been a sharp rise in economic instability and in militarisation, concerns of Russian expansionism, and with the accession of Sweden and Finland to NATO, whether we like it or not, I am bound to say that militarism will not come down, it will go up. The Arctic is already viewed by the Tory government as much as a region for military activity as it is for one for scientific research. The JEF, the UK-led Joint Expeditionary Force, is about military capability, not scientific collaboration. And the price that is paid for all of this is the repression of Indigenous peoples' rights, the accelerated depletion, the commodification and the commercialisation of natural assets, the sacking of biodiversity and the wholesale appropriation of land. There is, in short, a new all-pervasive colonisation taking place in the Arctic, in which common lands and seas, culture, heritage, even an entire way of life, are being put in mortal jeopardy, all for the sake of the insatiable demands of extractive capitalism, of corporate greed, the maximisation of profits and the shareholder dividend. But whilst this chaos is creating conflict, it is also building resistance. Resistance from the 4 million people for whom the Arctic is home. Resistance to the nuclear power plant on the Hanhikivi Peninsula in Finland, now cancelled after Putin's invasion of Ukraine. Resistance by the Inuit people who forced the Canadian federal government to block the proposed Shandong mining takeover of Hope Bay gold mining on the grounds of national security. Resistance. Resistance too to global multinational corporations owned and registered here. Resistance to Rio Tinto in Canada, to Shell in Alaska. So when the Cabinet Secretary reminds us of Scotland's proximity to the Arctic Circle, of course he is right. We are a near Arctic state. But let me remind the Cabinet Secretary that it is the duty of this Parliament to press him on whether he means for us, actively or tacitly, to be complicit in this new economic, cultural, ecological, social and military colonialism. Or are we prepared instead to build an alternative relationship, to follow an alternative strategy forged on the values of peace and not war, of social advance, not economic exploitation, of conservation, of emission controls and climate change cooperation in place of mineral extraction, environmental dumping and corporate takeover. A relationship instead... Yes, I'll give way.
Mark Ruskell.
Thank Richard Leonard for giving point. I just wonder if he would then reflect on the importance that sub-nation states and also petrostates come together and commit to a just transition and to sign up to the Beyond Oil and Gas Alliance.
Richard Leonard. Yes,
I do support that, because I think that there is a debate taking place at the moment in Scotland, which is challenging some of the premises I thought that we'd accepted. And I think there needs to be an international approach to these issues of just transition which I wholly support. And let me finish by saying this, Presiding Officer. I think that we need to build a relationship where we respect cultural and biodiversity, where we support native communities and Indigenous wealth building, and where we provide practical solidarity to Indigenous trade union organisation too, because the earth is a common treasury which we must defend, but not with gunboats and the bellicose rhetoric of nationalism, but with ethical, socialist, ecological and humanitarian action. That is what our vision should be, a people's vision which reaches beyond economics, which looks to the bonds of our common humanity, and which has a shared vision of a future of peace, of justice and sustainability.
Thank you, Mr. Leonard. I now call Gillian Martin to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Ms. Martin.
Presiding Officer, just wait for my microphone to go live. You
got your card in. Ms. Martin, have you got your card in? Okay, could we have Ms. Martin's microphone, please? Thank you. Ms. Martin.
Thank you. Scotland and the Arctic have been intertwined for centuries due to our close geographical proximity. And so it makes sense that our ancient relationships are being reinvigorated, reignited, redesigned to match our modern times. Whether it's Norway or Sweden, Canada, Alaska, Iceland, Finland, there's common ground between us across a lot of issues, and we all stand to gain valuable knowledge through our interactions, backed by the new links that have been enabled by the Scottish Government's 2019 Arctic Policy Framework, launched by my friend and colleague Fiona Hislop. In parliamentary terms, I gained enormous insight into many of these common issues by attending the Arctic Circle Assembly in 2018 with Finlay Carson, and in 2019 with Mark Ruskell on behalf of the then Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee, having many bilateral meetings with politicians working in these portfolios from Iceland, Faroes, Canada and the Sami regions of Norway, Sweden and Finland. And at that time, our committee was working on the Climate Change Bill, now the Climate Change Act, and hearing from Inuit, Sami and Greenland communities about the devastating impact that climate change is having on their way of life certainly focused my mind on our responsibility to play our part in reducing our emissions. And everyone I spoke to was blown away by the extent of our ambitions in that area, and I'm very appreciative of them as well. The Scottish Government's ensuring the benefits of our transition to a net zero economy are being maximised, including through working with our Arctic neighbours, with considerable investment by companies based in the Arctic states, like High Wind Scotland, 25 miles off the coast of my constituency, now in its sixth year of operation, the world's first floating offshore wind farm. And that wind farm is built and operated by Equinor and has off-the-charts performance in terms of energy output. And now Equinor is developing, with all the lessons learned from that development, an even bigger project, the High Wind Tampen, which is situated off the coast of Norway. And the construction of the North Connect, the interconnector cable between Scotland and Norway, will allow us to exchange power and increase the use of renewable energy and create new trading opportunities for our renewable energy industries whilst improving our own and their energy security. Under the Scottish Government's Arctic Policy Framework, more partnerships are forming as a result of the Arctic Connections Fund. And in the second round of funding for the financial year of 2022-23 has funded 10 projects. And one project which piqued my interest in particular was on supporting rural women in Arctic low-carbon transitions. And this is led by the Scottish our Rural College in Scotland. And this transition to a net zero economy being a just transition, which ensures that no one is left behind, and that job security is protected and new opportunities are developed, in particular for women. So I'm excited for the aims of this project to establish a knowledge network pulling together women researchers, policymakers and community practitioners from across Scotland, Sweden, Norway and Canada to share knowledge about how best to support rural women during the transition to net zero in the Arctic region. And network members will share and explore existing local and regional interventions in their countries to build evidence-based recommendations for future policy around the issue. And that will shine a light on tailored support for rural women who may find themselves taking up new roles in the rural economy, setting up new businesses. And as convener of the cross-party group on women in enterprise, it strikes me that hearing from this team, once they've reported on this project, would be an excellent future session. Presiding officer, I will end with, we have natural and cultural links to the Arctic already, but strengthening our economic and academic relationships, growing cooperation between parliaments and governments, and sharing our expertise won't just be good for Scotland, it will be good for our Arctic neighbours and good for all of us who cherish the idea of reducing emissions and affecting climate change.
Thank you, Ms Martin. I call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Paul McLennan. Mr Ruskell.
Thanks very much. Look, I'm really grateful for the opportunity to discuss the unique position that Scotland has as the world's most northerly non-Arctic country, and I've really enjoyed all the contributions and insights from members so far. I have attended the Arctic Circle Assembly, as already been mentioned, twice as an MSP in Reykjavik. And I'd say I've always left inspired by the opportunities for collaboration and learning between governments, businesses, academia, and the third sector. And attending these events has more often felt like coming home than visiting away, such as the warmth of the gathering and the willingness of everybody there to share and to learn from each other. And it's clear that the geography, the economic, social, cultural history and the future of our climate all point to that need for greater collaboration between the people that inhabit and care for the Arctic and the subarctic regions. And in Scotland, you know, we're undeniably part of that world. And it is striking that when you tilt the map on northern latitudes, there is a seamless geography which runs from Greenland through Iceland to the archipelagos of the Faroes, Shetland, Orkneys and Western Isles and the west coast of Norway. And of course, this wasn't lost on our ancestors who explored, traded and inhabited this world. And we've already seen some of that history brought into this chamber from Liam MacArthur and Jamie Halcrow Johnson. It reminded me briefly that my own grandfather was stationed at Scapa during the Second World War in his work defending the Atlantic convoys there. But today, and if I can focus a little bit on Orkney, I have to commend the leadership of Orkney Islands Council, who have really prioritised their Arctic and Nordic engagement. And it is clear that both Orkney and Shetland in particular have much to gain and share with their neighbours. I do hope the Scottish Government can see that ambition as a real strength for Scotland as a whole, and that proposals to invest further in Orkney in their Arctic agenda are given serious attention by the Cabinet Secretary. Now, that shared geography of the West Nordic region means shared opportunities and learning. And I think I've been struck, as I think Fiona Hislop was, by the Faroese approach, for example, to developing fixed links across their islands, their ambition for offshore wind combined with tidal energy, and the growing development of a new industry, kelp farming. Now, we have a ban on kelp dredging here in Scotland, but there is a golden opportunity to develop a licensing regime that allows a productive, profitable industry to emerge in Scotland, creating hundreds of jobs while operating within our ecological limits. And of course, the Faroes in recent years have developed that industry. They've developed a licensing regime to achieve that objective. And I would urge the Scottish Government to learn on that experience and to act on it. But of course, if there's time, I'd be very pleased to. Yeah.
Just that Mark Ruskell and I were at the same meeting, I think, with the Faroese, and it was interesting that they said that they started this as a carbon sequestration exercise, but actually the value of the kelp that they were producing actually is a massive economic benefit as well.
Mark Ruskell.
Absolutely, and I think, you know, what was interesting is going back last year, we had a meeting with the same industry representatives who we met when we were there several years before, and seeing the development of that licensing regime over that time was really interesting. And again, we had interesting discussions with colleagues from Orkney who are now looking to develop such an industry there as well. But you know, learning cuts in lots of different directions, and following the meeting that Fiona Hislop has already mentioned with members of the Icelandic Environment Committee in Reykjavik, they did return that visit here to Holyrood in January. And we had a very productive discussion about how onshore wind has been developed here in Scotland and how Iceland can learn from us in that regard. But it is clear, as a number of members have already said, that our greatest shared endeavour is to save the Arctic from the ravages of climate change for the sake of all humanity. And Katrín Jakobsdóttir, the Green Prime Minister of Iceland, I think summed it up very well in her speech to the Arctic Circle Assembly last year when she said that the Arctic may become unrecognisable in a few decades if we do not act sufficiently today. Everything is changing. We see glaciers receding, permafrost is melting, heat records are beaten and forests are burning. And all this is happening much faster in the Arctic, where the ecosystem is sensitive and the resources are great. So we know Katrín Jakobsdóttir has been instrumental in leading the shift in thinking to deliver a well-being economy alongside Jacinda Ardern and Nicola Sturgeon globally, an economy whose foundations are ecologically restorative but also socially fair and just. So as we move towards, in closing, presiding officer, as we move towards the election of a new First Minister in Scotland, I hope that well-being economy mission remains central to this government and that we take on the challenges and threats to the Arctic, her nature and her people together as one. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roscoe. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to speak in this debate today. Last month at a Business in the Parliament event, I attended a workshop looking at export opportunities. This was hosted by the Scottish Chambers of Commerce. Business after business told us of the issues of trading with countries in the EU due to Brexit. They needed to look at new markets in which they could export. Many were looking at the North American market, but it was quite startling how many were now looking at Arctic states as well, and that was mentioned quite a lot by the companies represented. So replacing EU markets shows the importance of looking at Arctic states and is key to our economic success. Now, the Arctic Connections, Scotland's Arctic Policy Framework, was produced in 2019 and introduced, of course, by Fiona Hislop. Scotland does lead to Nuuk North. Scotland's northernmost islands are closer to the Arctic Circle than they are to London, and we've heard Liam MacArthur and Jamie Halker-Johnson talk about the links to Orkney. Connections between Scotland and the Arctic, however, go much further than the geographical proximity. Our communities share deep cultural and social links, as well as similar challenges and outlooks. The North Arctic Policy Framework consolidates our position as a Northern European gateway to the Arctic, establishing Scotland as the international partner of choice in tackling shared challenges, and I'll touch on these in a little later on. Now, the key things that are mentioned in the framework are climate action and renewable energy solutions, connectivity, science, research and innovation, and sustainable marine economy. Only a few months ago, I, along with colleagues from the Renewables Cross-Party Group, including Sarah Boyack, met parliamentarians from Iceland to discuss renewable aspirations. And I think Fiona Hislop already mentioned a meeting with the Net Zero Committee held the same day. We discussed the solutions about what we were looking at in Scotland. In particular, we're interested in community engagement, skills development, and of course, supply side development. These discussions open up opportunities for our own renewable sector and allow export of our expertise in the market. Now, the policy framework sets out Scottish expertise and encourages mutual learning between Scotland and our Arctic partners. It sits alongside other complementary strategies, such as the Nordic-Baltic policy framework, helping ensure that the best practice and innovative ideas like the baby box are shared with like-minded regional neighbours. The Arctic Connections Fund is one of the most virtually fruitful projects to arise from that framework. Now, it was launched in 2022, and Scotland-based organisations are encouraged to apply for grants between £1,000 to £10,000. These organisations must propose a project that explores the shared issues between Scotland and the Arctic. Scotland's links with close neighbours in the European Arctic are invigorating rural economies and protecting our natural resources. And we've heard that the Northern Periphery and Arctic programme secured over €6.8 million for Scottish organisations between 2014 and 2019 alone. And since 2014, Scotland was also granted £12.1 million through the North Sea Regional Programme. Now, unfortunately, we've lost that funding opportunity. Now, we do have other collaborative projects, such as Scotland and Denmark's Memorandum of Understanding to promote cooperation on district heating and energy efficiency, and that's incredibly important. I visited Denmark when I was a councillor about 15 years ago to look at their district heating systems at that time. They were ahead of us then, and they're miles ahead of us now, so we've got to learn from them in that regard. Now, of course, we need to replace some of the European funding that we fell short of because of Scotland leaving the EU, and that's still an issue in that regard. The Scottish Government remains determined to protect Scotland's reputation as an open and outward-looking nation, addressing acute global challenges such as those of climate change. Presiding Officer, in conclusion...
Sarah Boyack.
Thanks very much, Very much appreciate that. Just listening to your comment about how far behind we are now in terms of Denmark and community heat networks and renewables, is there something we need to be doing with political leadership to link up our councils and the Scottish Government to actually see what's possible? Because we have some excellent schemes, but they're not everywhere. And we need to move from it's a good idea to we need to do this as standard practice and make it happen.
Yeah,
Paul McLennan.
I agree with that point. One of the key things, I think, the existing homes lines mentioned around about how we tackle the retrofitting challenge we have is tackling it at a local authority basis. So that's something I'm working on in my own local authority, but it's something I would ask other local authorities to try and work on as well. So I would agree with the point that's made. So, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, we share many interests with our Arctic neighbours, but we need to develop these closer. This framework helps us do that. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be taking part in today's debate because as someone who represents Aberdeen, I know that trade links to the Arctic and to Norway especially are so vital. And it's Norway, a country that I've been to and enjoyed visiting many times, that's going to be at my heart of my contribution today. Aberdeen is twinned with Stavanger, and I've had the pleasure of being in Stavanger on a number of occasions in my previous role working in the oil and gas industry. And Aberdeen and Stavanger are a perfect twinning, with both areas' economies relying heavily first on fishing and latterly on oil and gas. And this partnership and friendship remains strong, with Stavanger even gifting Aberdeen a Christmas tree each year. So I was actually pleased to read the 2019 Scottish Government document, Arctic Connections, which has been discussed already today, which has a section on oil and gas. The section even states the industry supports a total of 110,000 jobs in Scotland, when including direct, indirect and induced employment. It goes on to say a strong domestic oil and gas industry can play a positive role in supporting the low carbon transition in terms of transferable skills and infrastructure. And, Presiding Officer, how much better things were in 2019 before the Greens were in government. The SNP of old seemed to understand how important the oil and gas sector was to our economy and our transition. But that now seems to be a distant memory from this anti-growth, anti-business devolved government. Another part of the Arctic Connections document that caught my eye was digital connectivity. It states the challenges of broadband deployed in the Arctic are akin to those encountered by Scottish remote communities. Like Scotland, Arctic states have established broadband speed and coverage goals to increase connectivity in sparsely populated areas. But while the Scottish Government have made a complete mess of the R100 scheme and missed their goals, Norway, as we'd heard earlier, has some of the best fixed and mobile speeds in the world. Presiding Officer, this shows it is possible and something we should strive towards. Another similarity between Scotland and Norway is the island communities. But it seems while Norway are investing in low-carbon vessels, we are investing in Norway's old diesel fleet. We should be looking closely to what Norway is doing, and if we are serious about meeting our climate change goals, then looking to invest in electrifying our harbours is a must. Fishing is another area where we have common interests, and we should be working closely with our Arctic partners to ensure we fish in a sustainable way and also to learn how to transform our seafood industry through increased automation. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I agree with the motion that we should be collaborating with our Arctic partners. I also agree that we should learn from them. We should learn how to protect our oil and gas industry, as they are a key part of our energy transition. We should learn from them how to run a ferry service that is reliable, greener, and helps support our island communities. We should learn from them how to grow our fishing industry and invest in automation. We should learn from them how to roll out a decent broadband service. We should learn from them how to roll out world-leading telemedicine to our rural communities, so our rural communities are not left behind. We should learn from them how to build a decent car charging infrastructure. In fact, this precarious SNP Green government should learn from our Arctic neighbours how to run our country properly. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So in recent weeks, a close family member who is on a work placement in Norway has been sending me regular pictures and videos of the Northern Lights, spectacular displays of colour in the sky that graced many of our skies in Scotland earlier this week. But the Arctic is a lot more than lights in the sky. Indeed, the Scottish Arctic connections forged through history continue to drive new and creative partnerships, exchanges and cooperation. Scotland's historic connections with the Arctic are extensive. Aberdeenshire-born polar explorer Thomas Abernethy was awarded five Arctic medals in the 1800s and was one of many Scottish explorers recognised for their pioneering polar research. And recently, RAF Lossiemouth has been re-established as a key airbase in the north of the UK, with a new fleet of maritime patrol aircraft monitoring the North Atlantic and the High North, at a time when tracking emerging military threats has never been so relevant. And I note the comments of Sarah Boyack and other members on the issue of global security, and I agree completely with them. Of course, our Arctic connections are embedded in our cultural and social linkages, shared climate change targets, and the interchange of information and expertise that is reinforced by shared policy ideas and initiatives. And I commend the Arctic policy framework developed by my colleague Fiona Hislop that sets out the priorities to develop our Arctic connections in a modern Scotland. And an excellent example is the Scandinavian Barnhouse or Bairnshus approach that ensures children who are victims of violence or abuse will have all their needs met in an integrated way in one place under one roof. And I'm delighted the Scottish Government has committed to implementing this internationally renowned approach in the programme for government. And I was pleased to receive confirmation that the 2023-24 justice budget includes £2.5 million of additional funding for victims and witnesses, including supporting the justice aspects of the next phase of the Scottish Bairnshus model. Presiding Officer, turning to research and innovation, Scotland Arctic Connections Fund continues to support academic collaborations with our Arctic partners, and it's testament to the strong linkages between the North East and our Arctic friends that the University of Aberdeen and the Robert Gordon University in the North East have successfully received funding to support a number of projects. A just transition project that will identify the challenges and opportunities in optimising regulation to achieve a just transition, a project to explore ways in which Arctic region countries address the challenges of outmigration of young people that will inform interventions and good practice in Scotland, and a project exploring the sustainability of an Inuit community in the Canadian Arctic. And I couldn't not mention the strong energy collaborations between Scotland and the Arctic. For decades, Scotland has been home to many people who have settled in the northeast from Arctic countries, bringing their skills and knowledge into our oil and gas and now our developing renewables sector. And I have to say, I was very dismayed at this sort of political nuances and tone in Douglas Lumsden's debate contribution a short time ago. Equinor's development of the Kincardine project, the world's largest floating wind farm just off the Aberdeenshire coast, is but one of many examples of our solid energy relationship. Presiding Officer, Scotland is rightly positioning itself as a key Arctic partner, embracing new friends, growing powerful links, and strengthening our internationalist reputation. Much to be proud of, but still much to do. And as a constituency MSP for Aberdeen South, I look forward to receiving my invitation to the forthcoming International Arctic Exchange Conference. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call Kenneth Gibson, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I first wish to apologise to the Chamber for missing part of the Cabinet Secretary's opening speech. Just 2 days before the Arctic Circle Japan Forum meets in Tokyo, I'm pleased that we are taking the opportunity to discuss Scotland's existing links with our Arctic partners and the ever-increasing number of opportunities to collaborate with Arctic states, nations, regions and communities. Perhaps it's human nature to conjure up a mental map when we talk about our economic and cultural links with the world. On a daily basis, we talk of our relationship with other devolved nations on these islands and London. In recent years, Brexit and our place in Europe has increasingly dominated our thinking. And in global terms, we think about the power balance between East and West and our place lodged somewhere between the USA and China. On the mental map, this consideration takes us south, east and west, but rarely north, or certainly not as much as we should, despite strong links dating back to the millennia before the Viking era. North to Iceland, Greenland and the sweeping North Atlantic corridor which links these nations with Norway, Sweden and Finland in the east and the USA and Canada in the west. This vast tract of our planet and Scotland's place on its periphery merits far more of our attention. While Scotland is not itself an Arctic nation, we are one of the planet's most northerly non-Arctic nations, and as a good global citizen, we have a strong interest in fostering greater mutual learning between Scotland and the Arctic, and playing our part in fighting the very real climate and nature loss the Arctic faces, and which colleagues have rightly focused on in great detail this afternoon. Scotland has much to learn from our Arctic neighbours. We also have much to offer. I'm pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary relay the feedback he received that Scotland is increasingly viewed as a place that is home to innovation, research, learning, technology, and the development of solutions that can benefit the entire Arctic region. That is something we can all be proud of and should be proud of. And the contribution Scotland can make is not limited to one particular area of expertise. It's across an entire range of sectors and industries. And I look forward to hearing examples in the winding up of period of this debate of some of these. I've heard a few already. Now, only a few months ago, my colleague Audrey Nicholl has just spoken, hosted Robert Gordon University in Parliament, which outlined the high ambition Scotland should be setting to become a global energy hub, building on their existing energy expertise to become a centre where new energies, like hydrogen, are developed, produced and transported directly between Scotland and our Arctic neighbours. Scotland's energy industry is, of course, world-leading. However, our expertise lies not just in the technical development of renewable energies, but in pioneering marine special planning to maximise the potential of these projects in an environmentally and economically sustainable way, and in partnership with communities and industries. The opportunity for knowledge transfer between Scotland and the Arctic in this area is clearly huge, to say nothing of the positive impact the development of these new energies will have in actually preserving our threatened Arctic environment. Blessed with natural scenic beauty, Scotland and the Arctic have much in common, but with natural scenic beauty comes the challenge of managing the growing numbers of people who want to come and see it for themselves and indeed exploit the resources, which, for example, Richard Leonard touched on. And that's especially when we consider how environmentally fragile some of our most picturesque landscapes are. Scotland's practical experience in balancing a desire to grow tourism, protect our natural environment and generate sustainable economic growth are therefore of value to our Arctic neighbours, particularly in those areas where tourist numbers are currently low but growing exponentially. And of course, nations around the Arctic are hungry for its resources. We must resist some of those urges. Scotland's Islands Passport Initiative encourages tourists to visit more of Scotland's 96 inhabited islands, helps alleviate tourism pressure points and spreads tourism to wider regions. This initiative and our experiences in establishing it are of real value to our friends in the Arctic, and I'm sure Scottish civil servants will be in high demand at Arctic Circle events to share learning and field questions on its operation with, of course, parliamentary colleagues. Presiding Officer, Scotland prides itself on being a country that's home to big ideas that make a mark on the world. But more than that, we want to share our ideas, take our place in global networks and partnerships that allow this to happen. Through closer collaboration with the Arctic, Scotland can create new opportunities to share and learn, and I support the Scottish Government as it takes forward efforts to solidify these valuable partnerships with our friends in the Arctic.
Thank you very much. We now move to winding up speeches. I should say that we have a little time in hand, so I can be generous to those closing, and I call Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank the Cabinet Secretary, Angus Robertson, for bringing these important issues into the Chamber today. I echo the Cabinet Secretary's word on the importance of continuing our educational support towards the Arctic region, including in the preservation of indigenous languages. Scotland has a responsibility to cooperate and work with our northern neighbours. particularly now. Strategic cooperation with our European Arctic neighbours must continue to ensure a safe, peaceful and prosperous Arctic. There is much that Scotland and the UK as a whole can be doing to help support the Arctic region and its nations. The Arctic now exists as a complex environment with more state and non-state actors involved than ever before. As my colleague Sarah Boyack said, we must preserve the Arctic as an area of peace and cooperation. So we very much welcome the Scottish Government's support for our Scottish Labour amendments this afternoon. Russia shares 53% of its border with the Arctic Ocean. More than 2.5 million of Russia's inhabitants live in Arctic territory. This accounts for about half of the population of the Arctic worldwide. The Russian Federation are geographically and politically tied to the Arctic, and its presence in the region must not be overlooked. Under Putin's leadership, the Russian Federation have recently changed its state Arctic policy. It references no plans for continued cooperation with the Arctic Council and instead the pursuit of Russian national interest. Full strategic cooperation and engagement with all Arctic states will be simply not be possible while Putin's illegal war in Ukraine continues. Any framework set out to improve Arctic cooperation must not infringe on the diplomatic sanctions imposed on the Russian Federation by the United Kingdom and its allies regarding the illegal invasion of sovereign nation. The Scottish Government need to recognise this new reality and shape cooperation based on this high security situation. As my colleague Richard Lenders already commented, multilateral engagement must be at the centre of future cooperation efforts in the Arctic region. As my colleagues have already mentioned, the melting glaciers in the Arctic represent the devastating effect that global warming is having on our planet. Climate change and global warming have scrutinised the Arctic as a region. Changes in the Arctic environment are greater than everywhere else, and the temperature in the Arctic raises 3 times faster than the global average. This impacts across the globe. The Arctic should be at the heart of our sustainability goals. The current climate crisis poses a significant threat to the Arctic region and to its almost 4 million inhabitants. This is something that we can strive to cooperate on. Scotland and Arctic region should share the same climate action ambitions now and in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to bring this debate to a close in behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. We've heard a lot about Scotland's growing ties with the Arctic today, and while I recognise the importance of strengthening a relationship with Arctic countries, we must remember that we're debating a reserved matter. As we've heard in the contributions today, there are areas where we can strengthen our links with the Arctic. It's encouraging that Arctic Frontiers will hold a one-day conference in Aberdeen on the 17th of March. This will be a great opportunity to bring together speakers from the worlds of policy, science and business and have them share their expertise and identify new opportunities for Scottish and UK Arctic collaboration. For example, the just energy transition is one of the areas where we should seek to strengthen our ties and share scientific knowledge and expertise on marine pollution and biodiversity monitoring. Through organisations like Marine Scotland Science and the Arctic Connections Fund, the UK Government already do a lot of work to support our connections with the Arctic. the UK Government recently published its Arctic Policy Framework, which outlines the UK's commitment to the Arctic Council as a state observer. This framework outlines the commitment to protecting the Arctic's climate, people and environment, increasing engagement on issues affecting Indigenous communities, promoting and protecting biodiversity in the Arctic, and addressing environmental threats in the region. This framework also emphasises the Arctic region's importance for our security. Being part of the UK allows us to use our defence resources to protect our interests in the high north. We are all aware that this region is strategically important, not only to the United Kingdom and its allies, but also to aggressive countries like Russia. Presiding Officer, I believe that the Scottish Government should focus on the issues that matter the most to the people of Scotland. We must prioritise our economy, infrastructure and our public services, and collaboration with our Arctic neighbours to help us achieve this is welcome. I would like to highlight some of the points that have been raised today across the chamber. So Donald Cameron spoke about how he believed it was important to engage and continue to enhance a relationship with Arctic nations, share best practice on the climate change crisis, and that was mentioned by quite a few. Jamie Halcrow-Johnson spoke of the Orkney's Norse heritage, the long-standing ties between Orkney and its Arctic partners, and also others around the world. He also spoke about issues of depopulation. Angus Robertson told us about the pool of expertise that we have here in Scotland and what we can do for the Arctic and how our help is warmly received. Sarah Boyack spoke about the importance of focusing on the climate change crisis and working with our Arctic neighbours and the impact of the invasion in Ukraine. Liam MacArthur gave us a history lesson of Orkney and spoke of its ties with the Arctic. Richard Leonard spoke about his concern about the military. He spoke about threats from Russia and how they have said that the Arctic is Russian. He also spoke about the threats to the Indigenous population and also the need for climate change cooperation. Gillian Martin talked about the ancient relations being reinvigorated and for the need to help rural women on the way to net zero. And Audrey Nicholl told us about the pictures she'd received of the Northern Lights, which I think we've all seen this week, whether it be in Facebook or other social media. So it's one of the benefits of being up there, but she also emphasised that the Arctic is much, much more than that. Douglas Lumsden spoke of his association with Norway and how we can learn from Arctic states on areas like broadband, ferry fleets and fishing. And also there's other contributions from Paul McLennan, Mark Ruskell, Fiona Hislop, Kenny Gibson and Faisal Chowdhury. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, when people are waiting too long for treatment at Crosshouse Hospital, when A&E at AIR is threatened with reduced services, when high streets in AIR, Girvan and Cumnock need more support, and when drivers need to see improvements to the A77, I would much rather that we gave more debate time to matters affecting people in Scotland today and issues that are devolved to this Parliament. Presiding Officer, we need to work together with our fellow UK nations as well as our Arctic neighbours to create a brighter future for all Scots. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Angus Robertson to wind up around 10 minutes or so, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In my opening remarks, I set out some of the initiatives that the Scottish Government has promoted in recent years to deepen collaboration with the Arctic region. And in closing, I want to reflect further on the strategic objectives of this work and the approach that the Scottish Government is taking to pursue them. First, however, I'd like to respond to points made during the debate and made by all speakers from all parties, because I think, with some very minor exceptions, I think there has been a hugely constructive tone from all parties in this debate, which is warmly welcomed. Firstly, to Donald Cameron, who began by saying that Scotland does have an important role to play, a bit of a contrast from the summing up from his party. He said it's really important to engage with our Arctic and Northern neighbours, both economically and culturally. I agree with him. He said it is right to highlight, in addition, the difficulties posed by Russian aggression in Ukraine, and of course he is correct in that, and pointing to the risks to stability and security in our northern region as a result are an absolute given. And given the nature of the climate crisis, how important it is for us to be working with our Arctic and northern neighbours. He also very graciously, and I'm pleased it's on the record, was explicit in the Conservative Party's praise for the Global Scot and the International Scottish Trade Network, and I look forward to hearing more about that from other colleagues on his benches in future debates. Sarah Boyack from the Scottish Labour Party talked about the twin challenges in relation to climate security and global security, and made the point quite rightly that the aggression of Russia has meant that there's a diversion of collective focus away from the climate crisis, but we must not lose sight of the scale of the climate emergency. She also put on record her party's growing interest in the likes of Scotland being able to sign international agreements. I look forward to her party making even further developments in recognising why being a normal international nation as a sovereign state is a good thing. Liam MacArthur rightly drew attention to the historic connections between Orkney and Arctic neighbours. He had a long list of areas of cooperation, actual and those which can still reach full fruition, and I totally agree with those. To Fiona Hislop, I'd like to pay tribute to her, my predecessor in this office, for all that she did and continues to do to promote links between Scotland, the Arctic and High North. And she, in particular, pointed out the opportunities that we have with our northern neighbours in the fields of renewables, in particular hydrogen, and I can attest to that through the conversations that I've had with decision makers in our neighbouring countries have a huge interest in the potential for cooperation with Scotland, something that we should, I would of course.
Liam MacArthur.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention and very grateful too for his generous remarks. I couldn't help but notice though that he ducked the question in relation to Orkney Islands Council's, I think, and other partners' determination to see Orkic and Stromness become a centre of excellence, if you like, for research on the Arctic and Nordics. I just wondered whether the Scottish Government would lend support to that, as well as the idea of a reprise of the 2019 conference in Stromness.
Well, and forgive me, I did overlook that, and I shouldn't have. I have a long list of points that colleagues made, and I'm sorry, I didn't mean to skip over that. I'd like to look very closely at the proposals that are being made. It would obviously be a development of a hugely positive centre of excellence and the event that took place in Stromness. I think he's right to highlight the role that Orkney Council has been making. I regularly meet the convener when attending events in our northern region, and I've strongly encouraged him and other colleagues to look at the likes of the Mayor's Network in Arctic Frontiers as a way of local authorities also being able to take a direct role in relationship with other parts of the northern neighbours. But this is the beginnings of a conversation with Mr. MacArthur that I look forward to being as helpful and supportive I can be. To Jamie Halcrode Johnson, obviously a man from the Northern Isles, so he knows exactly how important our historic but also our current links are. He talked particularly about the issues of depopulation, of rurality, of connectivity, and he's absolutely right to do that. Richard Leonard talked about geostrategic instability, and he has good reason to highlight that, as well as the importance of the rights of Indigenous people, people whose communities may be in jeopardy and under threat, posing the question, which priorities are being pursued? Are they extractive? Is it in terms of militarisation? Can I say the Scottish Government is committed in particular to renewable cooperation, but also to stability? And we cannot avoid the fact that we are seeing challenges that we need to think about in new ways. It wasn't that long ago that we saw sabotage to the subsea infrastructure of the Nord Stream pipeline. And for all of our nations who have an important energy focus, we need to make sure that we have all of the tools at our disposal to make sure that we are not subject to that kind of malign influence. Gillian Martin talked about the importance of emission reductions through cooperation, and there's so much that we can do as groundbreaking nations in Northern Europe and the Arctic. Mark Ruskell highlighted attendance at our Arctic cooperation events. He was at events. Gillian Martin was at events. I think Douglas Lumsden has also been at events. I think that is hugely worthwhile. So to other colleagues who have taken part in this debate or have listened to the debate, forgive me, I haven't mentioned you, your attendance at these sort of events, I strongly encourage each and every one of you to think of doing so. And obviously we have the conference in Aberdeen on the 17th of March as a good starter for those of you who haven't been at one yet. But I'm very much looking forward to seeing colleagues from all parties at future Arctic and Northern events. Mark Ruskell talked about wishing to build on the ambitions of Orkney and Shetland for the rest of Scotland. I think that's absolutely right. And he highlighted the role in Prime Minister Katrín Jakobsdóttir from Iceland, and she does deserve particular praise, and highlighted the parallel approaches of the Icelandic government and the Scottish government in terms of the well-being economy. And I note for the record her warm words of praise for our outgoing First Minister, and indeed those warm words from President Ólafur Ragnar Grímsson, which have been very well heard and received here in Scotland. Paul McLennan talked about the potential for local authority connections. He's absolutely right to do so, and we need as many parts of Scotland to realise the huge untapped potential that we have for enhanced relations with our Arctic and Northern neighbours. Douglas Lumsden spoke very persuasively about the importance of the Aberdeen and Stavanger links. He underlined the importance of the energy sector and the transition that is faced in both Norway and in Scotland. Indeed, this was the subject of my discussions with the Norwegian State Secretary for Energy, Andreas Bjelland Eriksson, only a few weeks ago. He said we should learn from our Norwegian neighbours. Hooray! I totally agree. I listened closely to his speech. I think he missed out the last page where he missed out the success of Norway having become independent in 1905 as one of the poorest countries in Europe to now celebrate its success as one of Europe's richest. Of course, Norway set up an oil fund which will be able to fund its public services in perpetuity, something the United Kingdom government has not done for ourselves. With permission of colleagues, I just want to conclude in reference to the final speakers. To Audrey Nicholl, she talked about our geostrategic importance. She's absolutely right about that. She highlighted Lossiemouth. I should say we have been trying to be consensual on most of these issues, but there is more that can be done in terms of our geostrategic cooperation. And I note that when it comes to Northern air policing, which is organised through NATO, of the nearly 50 deployments that there have been, the United Kingdom has only ever been able to provide one deployment as part of NATO Northern Air Policing, something that I think all of us would welcome a much more full-blooded level of commitment towards. Audrey Nicholl also talked about the advantages of social policy cooperation, ideas like the Barnhus, the Bernhus approach and the baby box, and there's more that we can do there. Kenneth Gibson talked about technology and innovation. Faisal Chowdhury, the cross-party approach to this issue, absolutely right. There's much more that we can do together in this, and he reminded us of the accelerated speed of global warming in the Arctic and high north, which should spur us on to act more in concert with others. And Sharon Dowie, just as a minor correction to Sharon Dowie's words on behalf of the Conservative Party, we have this afternoon been debating external affairs, which is a reserved responsibility. We've been talking about, as she mentioned, the importance of the economy and infrastructure, devolved areas of cooperation. And if she hasn't already read it, indeed if any other colleague has not yet read it, I would draw their attention to the Scottish Government's excellent Arctic policy framework, which outlines all of the devolved areas in which Scotland is cooperating with our northern neighbours. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, Going forward, the Scottish Government will continue to engage and mobilise expertise across Scotland to promote our offer among Arctic audiences, encourage knowledge exchange and support sustainable economic development. A Team Scotland approach is required if we're to fully seize the strategic opportunities offered by Scotland's role as Europe's gateway to the Arctic region. I therefore welcome the cross-party investment in international platforms such as the Arctic Circle Assembly. I know Liam MacArthur and members of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee were there last year. Many of the matters that this Parliament is responsible for have direct relevance to Scottish Arctic collaboration. Therefore, invite members to work with the Scottish Government to continue to promote Scotland as an expert and committed contributor to Arctic cooperation. And I think the tone of this afternoon's debate and the cross-party approach should give us all confidence that that is indeed the case. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Arctic connections, Scotland's growing links with the Arctic. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, and I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
And moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 8073.1 in the name of Donald Cameron, which seeks to amend Motion 8073 in the name of Angus Robertson on Arctic connections, Scotland's growing links with the Arctic, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The amendment is therefore agreed. The next question is that Amendment 8073.2 in the name of Sarah Boyack, which seeks to amend Motion 8073 in the name of Angus Robertson on Arctic connections, Scotland's growing links with the Arctic, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The amendment is therefore agreed. And the final question is that Motion 8073 in the name of Angus Robertson as amended on Arctic connections, Scotland's growing links with the Arctic, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And that concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.